one colleague from University of Pau, in the southwest of France, and he's a rather big team, and the lab is a laboratory of complex fluids, and it's a mixed lab with Total, so again with gas and petrol, and much money.
Okay. I don't know.
Yeah, is on the chair of CNRS. Particular in that.
Thank you for the precision.
Okay, thank you. So I'm the last of the day, so I will try to be quick. So I will present you some research work. The main work has been done by a PhD student, which is called Laurent Perrier, and by two colleagues, Frédéric Plantier and Gilles Pigeot-Dicabon. So the talk is about the deformation which can be induced by adsorption in a microporous media. So it's an academic work, but I wanted to present you some potential industrial application. For example, in case of the study of enhanced Coleman methane recovery, the idea is to use CO2 to enhance the recovery of methane in Coleman methane. And so the idea is that the carbon dioxide is better adsorbed than methane is such a cause. So the carbon dioxide will drive out the methane, so it will enhance the recovery. At the same time, it can be used as a technique to trap the carbon dioxide in the soil, so to reduce the quantity of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. So one of the issues is that in such coal material, in fact, it's a pure double porosity medium, meaning that you have the methane, which is trapped as an adsorb phase in nanometric micropores. So that's why you can trap a lot of gas inside, because the pores are nanometric, so the specific surface is very high in such material. The carbon dioxide will be preferentially adsorbed and will drive out the CH4, but the system permeability is driven by the cleat system, so you have a double porosity and higher porosity, but the carbon dioxide adsorption may lead to a coal matrix swelling, and in that case, this swelling will close the high porosity, and this will reduce drastically the CO2 injectivity. So this has been studied for a long time for such materials. So why the microporous matrix swell under adsorption? If you consider classical pore mechanics and you consider porous media with a bulk pressure, you increase the bulk pressure. If you have just mesopore or macropore, meaning that you do not have a high confinement effect, so I will define what is the confinement, just the slide after that. Finally, the equation leads to matrix shrinkage, meaning that you increase the bulk pressure and you will shrink your porous medium. Because in fact the thermodynamics quantities such as the pressure or the density inside the pore, since the pores are very large, finally the thermodynamics quantity inside the pore are the same as the thermodynamics quantities outside the pore, so you have the bulk pressure everywhere, so you will shrink the matrix. If you consider that you have macropore and that the adsorption of gas inside the macropores leads to high confinement effects, you will have a pore pressure inside the pore which is very, very higher than the bulk pressure outside the pore. And the same for the density. So this happens when the pore size goes down to the nanometric size. So the fluid is highly confined, and this leads to a matrix swelling. So So if we are going in the literature, so this has been studied for years. The first papers are at the beginning of the 20th century. At the beginning, it has been studied experimentally, and you can see here a chart presenting. So on the horizontal axis is the bulk pressure, and when you increase the bulk pressure, you will increase the quantity of mole which are adsorbed within the pores. So most of the time, this kind of chart is presents the excess quantity of mole, meaning that within the pore, if you have the bulk pressure and the bulk density, you will have a quantity of material, a quantity of gas, of mole of gas within the pore. And instead of plotting the total number of gas present within the pore, you plot what is the quantity of mole which exceed the bulk quantities. So why we are presenting that this way? Because this is the quantity you can actually measure experimentally. Okay, you have just access to what exceeds the bulk quantities. You can see here that carbon dioxide is it's easier to absorb carbon dioxide on this kind of materials, and you have a very large difference. And different authors present this kind of experiments, and for example, Oettinger and his collaborators measure independently the swelling of the matrix, and you have here the experimental results. So on the horizontal axis, it's still the bulk pressure, and on the vertical axis, it's volumetric swelling strain. Just to notice that it's not the same sample, the experiments are not simultaneous, and it's not even the same sample. Okay, concerning the modeling, a lot of people try to predict this kind of swelling induced by adsorption based on molecular simulation. The issue is that it's very tractable to get the isotherms, the adsorption isotherms, based on molecular simulation, but it's really hard to predict the resulting deformation at the macro scale, because you need to know exactly what is the pore network, and at this scale, it's down to the nanometric scale, it's not possible. So people try a different way. So most of the researcher try to present enhanced pore mechanical framework in order to predict the strain appearing at the macro scale. So I present here two models which are very similar actually. So you have the stress. Okay, so you have the elastic stress, and here you will add a term which represents the influence of the adsorption. In this kind of formulation, in fact, what you are changing is the porosity. In fact, you have more. In normal condition, you will have a number of molecules within the pore. Because you have adsorption, you have more molecules inside the pore, so you will change the porosity, saying that you increase the volume which is accessible to these molecules. In our group, thanks to Romain Vermorel, which did a postdoc a few years ago, we choose another approach that we will change the pressure. We'll say that due to the adsorption and due to the confinement effect, we have a pressure within the pores which is much higher than the bulk pressure. So that's the difference between the two models. The issue with this kind of model is that at this time, when we started our study, they were coherent with the experimental results, but not predictive, because in each model, there are some parameters that you have to fit. You have to identify on the loading path, meaning that you need to know the adsorption isotherm and the swelling curve to be able to identify your parameter. So you have a model which is coherent with the reality, but which is not predictive. For example, in this model, so you need the isotherm to estimate what is called a confinement coefficient. So this is a measure of what the quantity of mole within the pore which exceed the bulk quantities. But you need to you assume here that all the pore mechanical quantities are constant, and you need to identify them on the loading path. So the first improvement was to propose a predictive model based on the one we developed in the group. So to do that, we propose a new incremental scheme, meaning that the strain and the changes in strain and in the porosity are done incrementally. We update the number of moles that you can include within the pore by changing the porosity. We predict the change in the confinement due to the change of porosity. We update all the pore mechanical properties. And by doing that, we will predict the change in the porosity, and we will do that incrementally. Okay, so a change of the adsorbed quantities will provoke a change in the confinement coefficient. This will provoke the swelling of the matrix, so you will have a change of the porosity, etc., etc. So to estimate and to homogenize the elastic properties, we assume that for this study, we assume that we have a cylindrical porosity and which is randomly distributed. So the pores are cylindrical, but you have an isotropic response. So we use a classical homogenization scheme, to estimate the elastic properties. And at the end, what you need is the experimental data in the sense of the adsorption isotherm. So you will have the evolution of the bulk pressure and the bulk density and the adsorbed quantities. And knowing the initial state of your porous media, so the porosity and the elastic properties of the skeleton, you will be able to predict the swelling. So we did that for the experiment I presented you some slides ago. And it works well for both methane and carbon dioxide. Okay, so at this time we were happy, but this was done for a simple porosity media, and most of natural and synthetic porous materials are composed of two porosity, and what is really interesting is to be able to predict the change of the macro porosity, for example in the industrial case, the closing of the cleats due to the swelling. So you need to do the same study, but for a double porosity media. And we need more experimental data to be able to validate this kind of model, because in the literature, most of the because it was not done for this purpose before. So in fact, in the literature, there were no simultaneous measurements, or if there are some of measurements, but there is a lack of data just for the model validation, because the experiments were not performed for that purpose. So concerning the modeling, so finally we did the same thing, but just considering that we have two porosity. So just to explain, so we have a porous media. It is composed of a macro porosity and a micro porosity. So, and we assume, so that's a big assumption, that the two scales are separated. So we wrote all the equation for both for each porosity. So you will have excess adsorbed quantities in the macro pore and in the micro pore. You can estimate the total quantities. You can estimate the confinement within the macro porosity and within the micro porosity, and you can estimate the resulting pore pressure.
Sorry, if
there
is of are these micro and macro pores interconnected?
No. Yeah, the big assumption at this point is not needed, because but I will need to do some simplification, and I will I will assume that there is a total separation in the two length, the two characteristic length, both to apply the homogenization scheme, and both to estimate to make the link between what can be measured experimentally. Experimentally, you measure the quantity of mole which is adsorbed within the pore, but you don't know if it's within the macropore or the macropore. But
if I have a gas inside my topology,
yeah,
this gas can go in my topology.
Yeah. Everything is connected, and everything is homogeneous at this time. So you have your macropositive, which is within the macropositive. The macropositive, in fact, is a transport positive.
So we can talk out of normal.
Okay.
Excuse me, I have also a question here with respect to this equation. For me, this is a little bit disturbing to see that you have the same kind of equation for micropores and macropores. Because the physical phenomena are probably different, you have absorbed water in the micropores, while in the macropores, you have free water or something like that.
You will see that the coupling between the two will not be the same when I will start to make some assumption, because at this time I didn't say that the macro porosity is bigger than the macro one. On this slide, I just put the it's just to present the problem at the beginning, but I can invert the letter without any problem at this time, because I didn't say anything about the size of the macropositive or about what happened in the macropositive. You see what I mean?
Maybe a bit tricky to have two scales with the same equations.
Yeah. I think it's an error of presentation. It will be if I can pass to the next slide. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So that will be the next one. You start to do some assumption to say that the macro porosity is included into the macro one for the homogeneous purpose. Okay, so I will I say that I have two scales, and the two scales are separated, so I can homogenize the first scale at the first scale, and after that homogenize the resulting properties at the higher scale. I am using so here it's still purely symmetric, meaning the pore mechanical framework at this time, I didn't say what happened in the macro positive or in the macro one, so everything is purely symmetric, and here you have your coefficient which control the exchange between the two porosity. And when I will start to do assumption, I will have a change in this coefficient. At this time, everything is purely coupled, and you will have changed the macro porosity due to what happened in the macro porosity, and vice versa. But I hope I'm clear. Yeah. Okay. Now I will start some assumption, because experimentally I'm not able to make a difference between the quantity of mole which are adsorbed within the macropore or within the macro one. So I will assume that everything happened in the small porosity. Okay. So because the macro porosity have large spore, I will say that okay, there will have no confinement in the large porosity. So I put everything in the macro one. So I will say that it's okay, there is no confinement in the larger porosity, and in the larger porosity I have the bulk pressure. So the confinement effect, all the confinement effect is in the small porosity, and this will change drastically the coupling coefficient. And no, it is not symmetric at all. But you will still have an influence on what happened in the macro porosity due to the pressure within the macro porosity. But the coupling is not symmetric now. Okay, and the good point is that at the end, I have only the elastic property of the skeleton, which remain as a model parameters. And of course, the initial state of the porosity. But I have a predictive model. Now I need to check if the prediction is good or not. I will try to speed up a bit. So we develop a new experimental setup for model validation. So it is based on a manometric setup for adsorption isotherm measurements. So the manometric setup is quite simple. If you know exactly the volume, and you measure, you do isotherm, so you know the temperature, and you measure the pressure, so you know the quantity of mole. And so if you wait for the equilibrium, you know how much quantity is absorbed in your measuring cell. And so this has been done for a long time. But we couple this manometric setup with a camera, and we perform digital image correlation in order to obtain a full field measurements of the swelling. Okay, so this is the validation of the manometric setup, but I will pass that. Okay, so the digital image correlation, I guess everything in the room is knows the technique, so it's just to show what we can observe as a reference image. And here is a kind of a displacement you can measure. So you have the displacement, the horizontal and vertical direction. Here it is the norm of the displacement. We check that we change the coordinates, so we check that you have only a radial displacement and no orthoradial displacement. So you can estimate the strain due to the radial and the radial displacement, but it's easier just because the numerical the code is built like that. It's easier to estimate the radial strain from the norm. So that is the reason why I present the norm, but we check that it's work and that we have only swelling. And considering that you have a pure cylindrical sample, you can estimate the volumetric strain. But so that is the same kind of measurements that was performed in the past, but what is new here is that we will have access to the full field swelling measurement. So if the sample is not homogeneous anymore, we will see an interesting pattern. Okay, so this is the kind of measurements we can perform. So you can see that adsorption and desorption cycles are purely reversible. Here, in fact, we performed this first experiments on activated carbon, which is an aggregate of activated piece of carbon. So we have on the first cycle we have material consolidation because the material is not so stiff. So this first cycle I will not be able to compare with the model. So I will start the comparison after the material consolidation. So I just remove the first cycle. And here is the comparison between the experiments and the model. So here is the I'm sorry, I wanted to present recent results, so I have some French sentence remaining on the slide. I'm sorry for that. So here is the isotherm adsorption isotherm, and here is the swelling curve. So you can see that both for methane and carbon dioxide, the model provide consistent results. Okay, so this is on a synthetic material. If I, for example, if I want to understand what happened within the sample, and I want to see the evolution of the macro porosity, so the small porosity and the large porosity, I can compute now the evolution, the relative evolution of the porosity. I can see here that the macro porosity is still increasing under swelling. So at first, that can be strange, but it's because the sample is really homogeneous because it's a synthetic one, and it's really free to swell, and so both porosity are increasing because what happened in the macro porosity have an influence in the macro porosity. So we check on the equation that all the parameters are relevant with this kind of results, and we try to with the model to stick on what can be what can happen on the ground. So if you fix the strain equal to zero on the boundary of the sample, you will have the new set of equations, and then you will see that you will close your macro porosity, because now the sample is not free to swell, and so you will the increase in the small porosity will close the macro one. But it's not, we have no comparison with the experiments here, it's just the prediction of the model. But if the prediction is good for free swelling, we can hope that this result is relevant. Okay, just to finish, we did the same from on natural carbon. The issue here is that of course it is not as homogeneous as a synthetic one, so you can see you can have very very large clits, which are not not clits anymore, but actually a millimetric crack. So if you perform your digital image correlation, you will have this kind of patterns. So that's interesting, in fact, because you will see what happened actually on your sample. So it's quite new in this kind of in this kind of 2D. At, in order to compare with the model, the results that we can obtain with the model, we were interested in this area, which is quite homogeneous actually, and we show that we have a coherent, consistent results. And I will stop on that. So we have a double porosity per mechanical model for that, only for isotropic and homogeneous media this time. We have an experimental setup for simultaneous measurements of adsorption and swelling, and we have the full field displacement. And the pore mechanical at this time has been validated on synthetic and natural carbons. Okay, for the perspective, so we need to take into account the pore size distribution, because here I just have an information on the macro porosity but not on the pore size distribution. And if I have a large pore size distribution, it will affect the results drastically. And to do that, the idea is to estimate directly using the density functional theory. You can estimate, in fact, the pore fluid density and the pore fluid density repartition within the pore. So we are working at this time to estimate the pore pressure directly from density functional theory. So if we have the pore pressure within the pore, we do not need anymore the experimental isotherm to predict the swelling, and we have a purely predictive model. And I thank you for your attention.
Des questions pour
seems for me that homogenization will bring very interesting information concerning the nano size effect. So I don't understand why you want to use homogenization, but why don't you use this for nano porous effect?
We are working on the. I think you will talk about that tomorrow. We are working also on the nano the effect on the nanopore on the elastic properties for the homogenization purpose. At this time, in my model, at this time, I do not have a pore size. So that's the issue, that we should have an influence. When you are going down to the nanometric size, you should have an influence both on the elastic properties and on the adsorption properties. So I want to put the pore size within my model. What I want to homogenize is not directly the elastic properties. With the density functional theory, now we know the density repartition.
No, I'm not talking about DFT. It's about the first.
Yeah. Yes.
The pore size distribution is not the main point. The main point is that you have some nano.
Yes, okay, okay, okay. When I say the pore size distribution is that if you have a family of pores which are, for example, at 1.2 nanometers, and a family of pores which are in 1.5 nanometers, it will change. It's not the same. That's saying that you have a mean nanoporosity and that you just take into account the macroporosity. That's the idea.
My question is that you are focusing on mechanical aspects and you want to look about the pore size distribution. What we are showing is that the effect of nano size of the pore is very important.
I know, but when I talk about the pore size distribution, it's not the whole pore size distribution, it's that even the pore size distribution between 1 and 5 nanometers will have an influence. I don't know how to define the mean pore size diameter.
You did for the poroelasticity.
Yes.
You focus on the effect of pressure. But you can correct the mechanical part with the result available for nanoporous one.
Yes, yes.
This is my point.
Okay. And at this point, it seems to work without that. So I do agree. But
I'm not sure that this will provide a very important change in the result.
Yes, I do agree with you. I do agree. Yeah. No, I do agree. But it's something I want to check. So that's one of my perspectives. But yeah, okay. The most important perspective is to be able to estimate directly the pore pressure within the pore.
I agree with that. That's why to use DFT for capture things at the nanoscale. Tomorrow, my PhD faculty, she deals with sitting near afternoon. She will present some results on nanoporous effect using alchemistic simulation platform.